Oh man, so many drops. This is different though. You know, I started playing campaign mode again. And man, these angels are jerks.
Well, what do you expect? Welcome, Nephilim. Make yourself at home. Marry my daughter. You gotta remember that these are just simple beings. They're just part of creation. You know, the common fabric of reality. You know, morons. Oh, we're live. Oh, hi everybody. Whoa. Welcome to Westmarch Workshop. This is episode 99. The title has been taken by Legion. Because everything is Legion lately, so hey, why not?
All but, things becoming Legion.
Yes, welcome to the show. And, well, my name is Nineball, but most people call me Nineball. And this is my co-host, Leviathan.
Wow, you're on a different level tonight.
Oh, it's, for some of you might have picked up on it by now, but some, for those of you who might not have, such as my dear co-host here, Leviathan, that doesn't even know what a movie is, those are some, lines from the, late, great Gene Wilder.
I know he was in, the factory movie.
Yes, the factory candy movie. That one.
With the with the munchkins.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that was pretty sad though. I know some things about Gene Wilder because A, Mel Brooks was on the Tonight Show, Jimmy Fallon, and he was talking about some of their adventures together, such as Young Frankenstein. And then also we were talking about it at work, and some people were talking about that other movie. Yep.
Yep. That other one.
I retained a lot.
I can tell.
Mm-hmm. I believe you said the number of this episode wrong, though. What is that? What
99?
Ah, there it is.
999.
999. 999. Oh, my goodness. So, yeah, man. Didn't have you last week. I was pretty sad.
Yes.
Now I get to have you all to myself this week.
Ooh, baby.
So I need to know where you've been. Why were you stepping out on me and who with?
Well, you know, we had like kind of like those scheduling problems when we were originally supposed to record the episode on the 17th, and I would have actually went and done a solo show, except my internet connection itself is still kind of potato, and I can't stream. For whatever reason, like, I can play games, I can do the Skype call, but as soon as I go through to try and load up OBS, it takes up the entire bandwidth, and I just can't do it. So, and then because of my schedule with work and us going bi-weekly, when, you know, we went to go through and reschedule for last week, you know, I had work and then unfortunately couldn't make it. But, you know, for more interesting things, I guess I'll start with the Diablo-related stuff, as I've really beginning to feel the changes that they made to the season journey. And everyone has, like, that one part that they really dislike. For most people, it's the set dungeon, you know, as we've learned over, you know, months and months of reading viewer feedback on how much they hate set dungeons.
Yep.
Mine currently is the extracting powers, you know, into the cube, because that means I have to run bounties.
Yeah, this is true. So you're on the Lala train?
I am definitely on the Lala train. In Lala nerd words, there's, you know, we've got
that's
some
true,
you know, past guests on the show that have vehemently been opposed to bounties.
I don't see why they're so bad though. I get the tedium of it, because it, I don't know, to me it feels just different enough from what you normally do, especially when you're just like rift, grift, rift, grift, rift, grift. Then you get to go around and hop some waypoints and, I don't know, speed through things and kill stuff, which is pretty much exactly what you do in a rift anyway, but by, you know, by a different mechanism towards a different reward. I don't know.
Yeah. Plus, I guess it's like one of the last times I actually did was like chain running bounties like not in a group and like just going through and doing it solo, just because my play times have been at odd times lately. And, so I'll normally just go through, maybe log, do a couple riffs solo, so on and so forth. And the last time I was doing that, well, I guess the last time that I had went through and done that solo is when I lost my Demon Hunter in season 5. But it was in season 4 I had a problem where I was doing like Act 1 bounty, and then I'd get disconnected. And then I'd have to go through and start it all over again, do Act 1 bounty disconnect, Act 1 bounty disconnect, Act 1 bounty disconnect. And so I sat there with a shit ton of Act 1 bounty mats and, no way of using them. And just, I guess it's like that is like triggering in my head, because now I have a crap ton of Act 1 bounty mats in my bank, just because, I had to grind out a Ring of Royal Grandeur. So I was just hitting up those Act 1 bounties. And so they're all sitting there, and it keeps reminding me of that time. Oh, it would be a shame if you were to go through and do like 4 acts worth of bounties and then get disconnected.
See, that's if I were you and I knew that I don't like bounties, but I need a Ring of Royal Grandeur, then I would have focused my time when I was trying to get that Ring of Royal Grandeur, still incorporating doing all of the acts, so that way you're killing two birds with one stone. You're technically still moving towards your goal of getting the ring, albeit less efficiently, but at the same time you're being more efficient towards something that potentially down the road you would dislike as much, if not more.
Yeah, though at the time I was going and doing it with Dead Advocate, who is also chain running just Act 1 bounty mats.
Guys enabled each other.
Yeah, pretty much, pretty much. So that's where I'm at.
Fair enough.
It's yeah, the only thing that's really standing in my way right now. And then there's some other stuff which I kind of appreciate, because I've never converted a set item, and so I did that, in order to make another step in the season journey. And I've never augmented a piece of gear, but I've got the gym all set and ready. I'm actually I could just go through and throw on the gym right now, like onto my weapon, but I want to get it up to 50 before I throw it on my kind of like filler gym to get up to 50, so I can put it on. I have some decently rolled pants, which I won't be replacing, because I remember some of the things we've talked about in the past about which piece of gear you should augment first, because what
Yes.
is the one that you're going to be least likely to replace or target farm to replace as an upgrade to push you further.
Plus, if you're planning on going the entire route of the seasonal journey, I think you need to eventually do 3 augments of level 50. So, might as well throw the max on there, because I think it's like 1 of 30, 2 of 40, 3 of 50. And then you can save yourself the trouble of doing the intermediary steps, just doing the max.
There we go. So I am still progressing towards getting that sweet, sweet stash face.
Nice. All right, we'll look forward to updates. I myself, on Diablo front, because I know we'll be coming back to you for some other games.
What could that be?
I don't know. I have played super minimal amounts of Diablo since the last show, so since last Wednesday. I'm still playing my Softcore Crusader, standing in solidarity. And it's an interesting time because I really feel like I have an appreciation for my RNG on hardcore, because I think I sacrificed a goat or something along the way to have really good RNG on hardcore, and as a result, just shit RNG in softcore. And normally that wouldn't be a problem, but I guess now that I am back there, I'm realizing the side effects. Because it took me, I now can un like further understand and confide and feel the empathy with many of our listeners who write in and say it took me 18 million years to find a Ramalani's gift. So normally those are coming out of my ass on hardcore. And it took me like, I don't even know how long. I had so many weapons to use them on and no gifts to actually use in my Crusader buildup. So that was a weird feeling. And then I've just been stuck in Invokers for a very long time. I've been trying to assemble the ancient pieces for Long Bombardment, but that is coming incredibly slowly. Like, I barely have any ancient pieces in general, so it's just weird. And I'm like farming GR like 60, 55, and you know, pushing 70. I actually just did a 69 before the show started.
I giggity. Though I do have a question for you.
Yeah.
Are you counting your deaths?
So, you know what's funny is I am reveling in the ability to not use a cheat death, so I have never had one equipped since I made this character. And the only times that I've died have been when I've been like fighting elites and I'm looking at their fixes. I'm like, yep, that's got molten. I'm like, you know what? I don't have to move though. And so it blows up on me and I die. And I'm like, it's super weird because I'm conditioned to feel incredibly horrible when there's that split second where everything stops moving and you no longer have control because you're now dead. And in that moment, my heart, like even now, I know it doesn't matter, but my heart still sinks. Like I get sweaty a little bit, my palms, you know, mom's spaghetti. And it's just, I don't even know. It's so weird that that's it's like a Pavlovian response to that screen, but it doesn't matter.
And then 3 seconds later, you hit the button and stand back up.
Yeah, I revive a corpse. It's great. Different world, man, a different world. It's kind of, you know what's funny though is that especially because I didn't have a really good Traveler's Pledge to start out, so I was using a Hellfire Amulet. And I realized that when you don't have to take a cheat death passive, you can take another passive, but for a lot of the builds, there kind of really isn't another passive that you would want. Like I can kind of see why in general cheat deaths make it into, I mean, beyond the obvious points of dying in high level pushes does end up being terrible because sometimes you're, you know, scraping the side of a 1459 clear, so even dying once might, you know, screw you over.
Yeah, that's something that I have seen with some of the higher end softcore builds is they still use the cheat death passive because it can save, 30 seconds a minute off of your clear time just because that's it, it brings you back to life and that saves you the res time.
Exactly.
yeah because there's a lot of softcore builds that when they're going through and especially solo when they're going and they're pushing those higher end griffs that they might lose a minute or two in their total clear because they died so much.
Yeah, it's kind of it feels counter because you'd be like, oh, I should just take more offense so I can clear faster. But you definitely, if you continue to die, which I'm realizing is very easy to do when you're actually pushing more offense on your build, that it adds up on you. It can certainly add up on you. But yeah, I think so. To answer your question, yes and no. I think I've died like 3 or 4 times, but at some point I'm not gonna remember, and it won't really matter.
Yeah, once you really start pushing, it will be impossible to keep a tally of it.
Right. The freedoms. But you actually had mentioned, I guess, you know, not to jump into news, but you had mentioned that there's some DDoS attacks, so it's kind of like a good time to not be hardcore and instead be on the other side of the fence. But there is this other game that had a release, and we were discussing maybe it was tied to something like that, or maybe Overwatch salty banned players being salty, or but anyways, tie all these things together. What's going on?
Yeah, it's one of those things that there have been another rash of DOS attacks, and that's been causing a lot of disconnects. And if I wasn't playing Legion last night, I would not have been playing Diablo just because I got disconnected, I want to say at least 12 times within the matter of a couple of hours.
Well,
It
goddamn.
was yeah, it was really bad. And like you said, some people are saying, "Oh, it's the Legion launch." Other people are saying, "Oh, they're specifically targeting the Legion launch, because of some Overwatch bans and stuff like that." And like what I find is interesting, like this time around, is that they're not targeting Blizzard because Blizzard themselves actually has pretty good protections in place in order to kind of circumvent DOS attacks. But they've been attacking ISPs that tunnel into Blizzard. So, they're basically knocking out like certain regions will have lag where other ones don't because they're going through and hitting them.
Right, like I've actually seen a lot on Reddit, a lot of the European players particularly complaining that it's been really like laggy or just a ton of disconnects and things. So, and at that time, you might not see anyone in the Americas having an issue, and maybe vice versa, like later that day or in the night or something. Curious things. But you did mention a Legion launch.
Yes, the new World of Warcraft expansion is out. And for you know, I've noticed over the years that a lot of the large portion of the Diablo player base, or at least the vocal portion of the Diablo player base, doesn't really play Legion, or doesn't really play WoW. So not a lot of hype for Legion going into it. But you know, most Diablo players, especially if you're listening to the show, probably have a little bit more interest because a lot of Diablo developers have migrated over to the WoW team to go and work on that. We have, at least that the minimum that we know of is Don Vu and John Yang that went over and helped and were very instrumental in the development of the new itemization that's going into the World of Warcraft, the artifact as well as legendaries, and it does feel a lot more like Diablo. You have legendaries which function a lot like Diablo legendaries. You might have a ring that increases like your pet damage, or some shoulders that also buff your pets, things like that, that it will actually go through and help change up. You'll get one piece of gear which changes up how you play the game. It changes up your gameplay mechanics, just like Diablo legendaries did, which is something that you really had in World of Warcraft. You wouldn't have one item like completely dictate your build, with the exception of certain trinkets. But it's really interesting seeing those changes and how it affects in the meta that people have been discussing, towards the end of the beta. Now that we're into launch, people are like really knuckling down on it. So it's pretty cool. It's something that I really enjoy, and I'm having fun. They definitely improved a lot of the systems that kind of made me get burnt out on Warlords of Draenor, and just have to wait and see. Like it's great, but then again, Warlords of Draenor was super fun for like the first, I want to say, 2 months that I played before I got burnt out and tired of a lot of the repetitiveness. But if you're interested in the story, holy crap. It's so good, especially like I play a Death Knight, and the new class hall system, which replaces the garrisons, is amazing. The Death Knight story is awesome so far. Now, I'm not even 110 yet.
There you go. Yeah, looking from the outside in, from everything I've seen, has been very, very positive for this game, not only from the launch and there being very minimal issues, no major server downtime or anything like that, outside of, the random DDoS things that we've been talking about. But people have been commenting, especially on the look of things. Like, apparently it's very beautiful, like very nice graphics this time out. You've even noted some of the like Easter eggs that have been in there that you're noticing as a Diablo player. I have, and just before I let you go on that, I have also noted too, like Miss Cheetah, for instance, commented on not necessarily knowing how she feels about there being more Diablo, because there's also like the idea of like there's kind of bounties, maybe like the bounty system has worked its way into Legion as well. And so it kind of reminds me of when D3 kind of was brand new, was fresh. Everyone was like, it feels like a lot of WoW in here. I don't want any WoW in my Diablo 3. And now it's like, oh, we return the favor. Here's some D3 in your WoW.
Which, being a Diablo player, I don't mind seeing more Diablo elements in World of Warcraft because I really enjoy a lot of those things. Maybe not so much bounties.
Wherever
I
you
haven't
go.
hit yeah, I haven't hit 110 yet, so I haven't had any experience with like the world quests yet. But we'll see how that goes and turns out. And even then, there is something that I can do in my class Order Hall, which I can use to instantly complete any world quest on my map. So it's like it has like a 3-day cooldown on it, but it's like I really don't want to do bounties, so I'm just gonna talent for this one and Frostworm go over there and complete that world quest for me. Okay, done. Cool. I'm finished.
So you're
I'm
gonna be
good.
in the D3 forums like, we need to add a button that lets you complete Act 3 bounties and Act 4 bounties.
Yeah, and have a 3-day cooldown.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They did it in WoW, so
Yeah.
that's funny.
Yeah. Well, it's pretty interesting. I do. I even though I kind of got burnt out on it in the garrisons and Warlords of Draenor, they kind of simplified, refined the follower system in Legion. So now instead of having like hundreds and hundreds of followers and having to like, well, this one randomly rolled that trait and I have to go through and use this item to reroll it because I need this guy to have this one and that. You now have like 8 people. You just have 8. That's it, period. And they have set traits. So you know exactly what they have once you like max them out and such. And then what you can do to customize them and use, you get to equip items onto them just like you would equip items on your follower in Diablo. Hmm. So you can give them a little equipment to go out and do their missions. But I still like... I still think that there's more that they could do with it. And, you know, it's just... This system feels like it feels really nice, really fluid. But I like the duty officer system from Star Trek Online. I said StarCraft Online. Wouldn't that be a dream? Star Trek Online. StarCraft their duty is officers. Online. It is. It is online.
That's funny.
But, yeah.
I did, so kind of jumping us into the news, are we good on weekend gaming? Is there anything else that's super exciting in your
world? To go back to one of your comments, so like the your comment about the comment that I made on Twitter, apparently like the kobolds are breaking the fourth dimension. I remember in Wrath of the Lich King, they made it so that way some of the kobolds there would say... what was it? Kage Nishu. Yeah, it's kind of like a little reference to Fallen in Diablo, because kobolds are kind of like Fallen. There's these little gimpy things that no one really gives notice for, and they're known for being useless. But now the kobolds in Legion, I was attacked by one, and he actually, as he was coming and attacking me, he screamed out, Raka Nishu. So wow. they just, you know, well, let's skip subtlety and go straight for the reference.
hit the hammer on the hail is what I was about to say. Hit the nail on the you know what I mean.
Yep.
Good. Did it.
Yep. We did the thing.
I wonder if there are more of those too. It seems like they're getting really huge on these crossover Easter eggs though, because you know Overwatch is full of them. There were some of the ones that the D3 community was discovering, like that. Was it Hydralisk Skull or Ultralisk Skull or something like that?
Yeah, it was the Hydralisk Skull in the Act 2.
Mm-hmm.
One of the tile sets that could go through and spawn in... It was the area before the Black Canyon Mines. I can't remember the name of that zone now. Whatever. Some
sands thing.
I fail. Yeah. Scorching Sands.
Sounds good.
Yeah, let's go with that one.
But yeah, there's always... It seems like they're now just, you know... fully equipped to throw those into all their games at this point.
Which, yeah.
I mean, if you really boil it down, it's kind of just like cross promotion.
Yeah. And that's when they kind of redid the old world in a couple expansions ago in Cataclysm. I was going back and just exploring some of the quests. I play undead, you know, so I was just redoing a lot of the undead quests just to see how the story had changed for the undead. And, you know, I got this one quest in Brill, and the quest title was Always to the East, and then I just stopped there. I just kept that quest in my quest log so I could just run around with it, because that's something that some of my friends still joke. You know, it's like, which direction do you go? East. Always to the east. I can't help whenever I'm giving directions. If I tell someone to go east, that phrase pops up in my head.
Right. Classic Diablo.
Gasp, you are Horde. Who plays Alliance? God.
For the Alliance. Woo. No? Okay.
Lost me.
All right. Yep. We're gonna pretend we're not fighting now. No, we're fighting. Let's see. So you did mention that, you know, one of the main interests for a Diablo person looking at Legion is, you know, they stole our peoples, they stole our gerbs. They took our developers from us, and you know that is something that we know Blizzard does. They love their talent. They're very proud of their designers and people who do things for them, so they trade them around to their games when needed. Now my question, and I mean I don't know that we really know the answer to it though, but we can kind of spitball, is how long do they stay with Legion post-launch? Because now the game's out, Obviously, there's going to be some patches to release new raid content and things like that, but is the heavy lifting done? And now the devs go back to Diablo? Are they now working on the next expansion and sticking around? Thoughts?
Well, we already know from Gamescom that they've announced 6.1 in a new raid tier. So with a new raid means new items. That's just how WoW expansion works. You have the new patch just come out, it brings all new items. So you take all the items that you're currently wearing, you put them in your closet, never look at them again until you realize my closet's full. Let me go sell all this stuff for gold. And so the whole purpose of Don and John being over there, Don John,
I like it.
I like it, I really do. They are not 6.1, 7.1. Sorry, thank you, Dread. That they're, if they were kind of like brought over to design these items, logic would kind of go through and say, well, there's still more patches, there's still more items to create, so they're still going to go through and keep them on. And until we get any actual confirmation of anything big going on in the Diablo community, there's not much of a reason to have them go through and come back. They're going to continue to make like improvements and stuff, with the game that, what we can talk about the developer insight that we got today. It seems there's still going to be some changes because there's still plenty of old items that don't have legendary properties yet, but that's not something, if you're going to only add a couple of items in, you don't really need a
A
major
lot of hands
designer
on
sitting
deck to
there.
help.
Yeah, you can do it because we go through and we talk, oh, they stole these devs, but there's so many other associate designers and developers that aren't in the public eye that are sitting there, or even major ones like Travis Day, that we haven't seen or heard anything from for a while now. He had he was at BlizzCon, but he had hasn't really talked all that much before that or afterwards.
Ooh, you had to mute that sneeze. Yeah, you're right. And actually, you just reminded me of a funny thing, because one of the talking points that we had a couple episodes ago was, what is Travis Day doing? Maybe he's working on D4. And so, Jimmy, DJ Tyrant, who helps out BlizzPro with some writing and some of the other podcasts, he went to the Legion launch event, which was in Santa Ana, California, the night before the game came out. And he got his box signed and noted that there was a Travis Day signature on the top of his box. And we were like, oh, so
Dun
that's where
dun
Travis
dun.
Day has been. That sneaky little guy.
Q sky is falling. Travis Day has left the Diablo team.
Him too? Et tu, Travis Brute?
Oh,
And so Wyatt, funny enough, chimed in on Twitter and was like, by the way, you guys may not have known this, but there are two Travis Days at Blizzard, which I had no clue. And funny enough, he said one is dedicated, the one we know, to Diablo, and one is dedicated to working on WoW. But what makes it even more confusing is that our Diablo, Travis Day, used to work on WoW. So that actually must have been crazy for them when they had both of them on the same team.
Or I'm not sure if the Travis Day that's working on WoW now was there when Travis was there, because he worked on it a while ago,
True.
before D3 got its train rolling. But that's something that we actually have talked about on the show a couple of times, because Travis Day is Ram Aladni, who there has a couple items named after him in World of Warcraft, because Travis was really, really big warrior tester in the original WoW beta under the name of, what was it,
In Dalamar.
Indolmar, which is, which he's flipped backwards to get Ram Aladni.
There you go.
And that just, he was very fundamental in helping tester the warrior class back then, and so they offered him a job as a developer. Which, he accepted, went out there, and has been working for them ever since. So that's how it goes. And
Sorry, go ahead.
yeah.
No, I was just gonna make a joke. I imagine that when they took Travis to help out with because I think he really came over and he was like the guy for we're gonna make these cool legendary items in D3. I imagine that WoW is now out there Travis Daylists, and they're going through interviews and they're like, we just have one question. Are you willing to change your name to Travis Day? We really like that guy. We just need another one, so.
Would you mind?
Oh man. But yeah, good points of, I guess they probably will still be needed over there if they are doing item creation, which you're the expert on what to expect in these upcoming WoW patches, so.
Yeah, and they've talked about it for the last couple of patches or last couple of expansions. I think ever since Cataclysm, they said that when they go into when they launch an expansion, they have a small team that goes and starts working on the next expansion. So like they were going and talking about shortly after MoP launched that they had a small team to go through and start working on Warlords. And Warlords launched, they'd already started working on certain assets and stuff for Legion. But we were going and talking about this that there was a really big lapses in between the end of MoP content and the launch of Warlords, and there was an even longer period of time between the end of Warlords content and the launch of Legion. And this is despite the World of Warcraft team getting substantially larger. That's it's I forget the term for it, but there is like this thing in like like kind of like business or like production theory that you can solve a problem or complete a task faster by having more people, so we hire more staff, but then we have to train the staff and bring them up to speed, which then costs more money and time, thereby pushing, the completion of the project back further. And so it's this fine point where, if you bring on too many people, you actually make the project longer and cost more money, to which kind of defeats the purpose of hiring all those people in the first place. But the nice thing is once it is set up, then the next project that you do after that, then we're golden on that one. Then we're
Right,
good.
you make it back on the back end.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll be curious because now that, having had that conversation with you offline, as we like to call it, or via text, it makes me wonder then if we'll actually see a Warcraft expansion announcement at BlizzCon. Like that could now, because for the past few months we've been like, what is there really to announce? And if they're serious about this rollout of, every year we're getting something out there, then it would be a prime time.
It's potential, and I know I've said this like almost every single BlizzCon. It's like I remember like for a couple of years, on the Diablo and Gamers podcast, I would go through and talk about, what are your expectations for this, for this BlizzCon? Oh, a new WoW expansion. And people would be like, oh, that's not possible. They're not going to announce a new expansion so soon. Cataclysm just came out. Mists of Pandaria just came out. Warlords of Draenor just came out. They're not going to announce a new one. Well, it's like every single BlizzCon immediately following the release of a new expansion has been the announcement of the next expansion. I think the shortest period of time was something around like 7 months, 6 or 7 months, between the launch of Burning Crusade and the announcement of Wrath of the Lich King. So it's literally following up, there where it's like they went through BlizzCon, here's Warlord, here is Burning Crusade, and then at the next BlizzCon, we're announcing Wrath of the Lich King. Oh, and here is also the announcement talking about some of the content that we haven't come out yet for the Burning
Burning
Crusade.
Crusade, right?
So it's always been that way. Now this one will be extreme because we're talking
Two
2
months.
months
Ah.
from the launch of the expansion to the announcement. But like we were talking about, if they want to roll out these expansions faster, like they've been promising that they would for God knows how long, then it would make sense for them to announce the expansion at BlizzCon. But, from last year, we had them announce Legion at Gamescom, not BlizzCon. So they could, in theory, announce it at E3 or PAX East or something along those lines,
True.
early into next year, and still be able to deliver faster expansion release.
This is true. It all waits to be seen. The hype will maybe grow for those who love WoW. And I suppose before we fully become a WoW podcast, we should probably talk some more Diablo.
I guess,
Is that
maybe.
okay? A little
Yeah,
bit.
fine.
Well, you did mention the magic word or words. You said developer chronicles. So would you like to lead us into this thing that actually just popped up? The Wednesday curse or gift, depending on how you look at it, is back. Whenever we have a show, there is news.
And so we actually do have some news and some stuff to talk about. Blizzard is launching a new semi-regular kind of article series titled Developer Chronicles, where they're going to go and talk about some of the issues that the community has. And they're starting it off with talking about Wrath of the Waste sets for barbarians. And a lot of people have, expressed their displeasure with how the set itself works and want buffs. And it really comes down to, especially if you are a hardcore Diablo player, when you thought of a barbarian, you picture Whirlwind. It's been like one of those iconic staples of the barbarian class,
Absolutely.
since the barbarian class existed, all the way back in 2000. And he kind of addressed some of the developers' concerns with going and buffing the system or buffing the set. One of them has to do with they want to try and cut down on the number of changes that they make to live items, where they'll go through and they'll fudge that for sets. They try not to make any big changes, but it also has some problems with the way the Wrath of the Waste set works with other sets, where it gets used in combination a lot with Rakdos and Immortal Kings. So if they make changes to that, to try and buff, say, like Whirlwind, it might also buff those other play styles, and so that gap will still exist. The little performance gap that they wanted to try and close and make Whirlwind compete with some of the other combinations that you could use with Wrath of the Waste, it's still going to be there because the other builds that use it are still also then benefiting from the multipliers and other sets. And so it's little things that they're looking to explore. And then also one of the other things, and I like how he put it, straight talk, Whirlwind causes performance issues.
Keeping it
And
real.
yeah, and this is, I am very thankful for, the candidness that they had with this and just being open. And it's like, we also are hesitant of buffing Wrath of the Waste and making Whirlwind like a top performing spec because our servers have problems handling it if Whirlwind is the top build. If everybody is running Whirlwind build, it causes a huge strain on the system and will cause performance issues. So this is one reason why we're not really going through and wanting to make this like your greater rift clearing build. They're happy with the way that the game has turned out because he says it's impossible to try and balance all 24 class sets with Legacy of Nightmares added on top of that to be 100% equal across the board. They're fine with going and tooling the different sets and kits to maybe have something that's targeted for. And Wrath of the Waste and Whirlwind is still pretty good for going through and hitting out just regular rifts, like if you're going and wanting to like key farm. But then when you switch over to like a group or really pushing your higher grade of rifts, that you're gonna switch out to something else, and they're fine with that. And that's something that you see across a multitude of classes, that they'll have their one particular build which is better for doing X, and then they'll have another build for doing Y.
Yeah, I mean, I think that in itself feeds into versatility, diversity, for classes. I think people, the dream is to see that across every activity, right? So you could have three speed farm builds and three grid rift pushing builds, and probably the reality is that it's never going to be that diverse. Maybe you'll see glimpses of it from patch to patch or season to season, but for the most part, there's always going to be that build that's mathematically 2% better than everything else. So that's what you see at the top of the leaderboards. When you grind it all down and make a fine powder. But two things that I think can tie together here that weren't necessarily talked about, but were kind of like talked around. One of the things I saw in reaction to this post was people thought that maybe it was the tornadoes caused, the dust devils caused by the six-piece set of Wrath of the Waste that were really the taxing part. And so they would rather see the power that's given to the tornadoes just pushed into Whirlwind itself, so that when you're actually whirlwinding through an enemy, you're dealing the damage versus I need to like spray my tornadoes. Like my Whirlwind is a delivery system for the damage, and it's almost like a range build. Another thing, which you touched on and that he mentioned, Wyatt mentioned, was the idea of we have to be careful with synergies. And you definitely do see the Wrath of the Waste set. I remember when it was at its most popular, Alkaiser had popularized this double rend build. And so you would use, I think it was, hopefully I'm not screwing it up, but I think it was 6-piece IK, 4-piece Wrath of the Waste, or some reversal of that. And basically, you only went up to the rend buffs. So you weren't really, you were whirlwinding, but more for the damage reduction that you got from the 4-piece. And then you were using the Lamentation belt for the double rends. And then the last rune on rend basically makes it so that when an enemy dies, it applies another rend. It transfers over its rend damage, basically. So you could stack up like 4 rends on the same mob, and it would do some serious dot damage. But when I was thinking about that, I realized that could also be a performance issue too, because if you're dotting that many things, I remember watching some of the high GR clears that Alkaiser was doing when he was using that build, and it was literally a slideshow. Like he would round up the entire rift basically, do his rends, and then you start to see mobs die, and then they're transferring their rends, and then it's just like damage. Pause. Damage. Pause. And so it was just this crazy,
Just
like,
too much.
am I gonna be alive in the next 5 seconds? Let's wait and see. Like, tune into next week's episode of Dragon Ball Z. So I don't know if that like is also another thing that they're considering as well too, is that if it does get boosted up, then also you bring back the Ren stuff, and then that could lead to some issues as well. So there's definitely, I think this was an interesting article to come out the gate with for this, what seems like it will be a pretty regular series, just because it's more than just we know that this is your favorite set and you want to see it, or sorry, your favorite skill for the barb and you want to see it perform well. Like there are plenty of things to consider before we make changes to it. Another thing that I wanted to tack on to that is something that I'm forgetting, unfortunately. So if you have something else to add, I might think of what I might say in that time.
The only really thing that I had to tack on to this was just like tinfoil hat stuff. I don't know if
We
you want to
always
go
welcome
into
that.
so yeah into speculation because it's just you can't help but you have like the Diablo unannounced project and members of the team working on secret projects and all this other stuff that everything is going to devolve back into is it expansion 2, Diablo 4, when are they going to announce it, all that other type of stuff. But I just wonder, just from reading this and like having this skill and like the whole issue with like the Helltooth set back in season 4, where you have the way that they designed it, have these huge performance issues which really impact gameplay, that when they go through develop, the next big thing, whether whatever shape that might be, are these things that they'll take into account when developing the next set of systems.
Right. And how would you account for that? Is it a matter of different slash better servers, or just like a way you build the game that optimizes better, or?
It was like the thing is like we know like with the Whirlwind build, we know it causes performance issues, but we don't know how or why. Like even you were talking about, people were saying, well, if it's the dust devils that are going through and creating the performance issues, well then take them out and just buff the bake the damage back into Whirlwind. Well, is it the dust devils that are going through and really causing the issues? Is it the fact that they're one of the big issues that people would always complain about when playing Whirlwind is rubber banding? Is it a matching the client to server position of the character, is that what's causing the performance issues? Is it, you know, because it's too many damage calculations, or the damage calculation happens too often? You know, there's all these things that could potentially breaking the system or causing the issues, you know, with the server, on the server side, I should say, that when they go through develop it, is it something that could be fixed by changing the way that damage calculations are handled? You know, is it something that they could do to handle like batch calculations on the back end? Is it something that they can, you know, better code to upgrade the current engine? Is it a problem with the engine, and so they have to design an all new one in order to like circumvent those issues? You know, it's a lot of things that, you know, we don't exactly know. We know that there is a problem, but we don't know what the problem is. Your check engine light is on, but what the hell, you know, is
good,
the problem?
Good comparison.
You know, yeah.
And, you know, like a lot of people in chat are saying too, like it's probably some combination of all those things that we're mentioning. So even that makes it tough, because it's like, well, what do you focus on? Do you try and make the servers better? Do you code better? Or do you try and do a little bit of all of it and hope it all works out? But yeah, sorry, go ahead.
It could be like when you say it's like it's too many damage, like if it's like it's because it has too many damage ticks having to go through and process simultaneously. You know, could the processing power of the server actually be able to handle it, but it's an issue with the way that the engine is coded and how it handles multiple damage calculations? Is it something that it has to like queue up a whole new like batch of calculations per mob, per character, per effect? Is it something that they could better streamline to have multiple damage sources kind of folded into one another to then, you know, roll over? It's a lot of different things that the way that it's actually handled in the engine could be affecting it. And then that will change how they could actually try and fix it. If it's something with how like the engine processes the damage calculations, or how it handles multiple like damage spells, like dots, like rend and such being applied to different mobs. You know, it could be something that is just that they can optimize and make faster or make it process better, but they could never fix without doing a massive overhaul of the engine. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of things that could be that could affect it.
Yeah, and you actually just reminded me of the point I was trying to remember, was that another thing people were potentially concentrating on was that they just don't like Rend being a thing in the Wrath of the Waste set. And I remember when it first came out, we were still getting Tavern Talks, which was awesome, but this almost feels like kind of the replacement to that in a way. You know, a move from streaming to get access to developers and more developer blogs, perhaps. But to bring back to the point, they were noting that they wanted Rend in there because when you're whirlwinding, you're getting the damage reduction, so you feel relatively safe, and you have movement, which also provides safety, at least repositioning towards safety. And so Rend was kind of that moment where I'm putting myself in danger to do this, but I should be gaining more power by applying this dot, or it should be positively affecting my build at the risk of potentially dying or, you know, taking very serious damage while doing it. And I think a lot of people, you know, to their chagrin or, you know, dismay, they really just want a Netflix with this build. So I think they would rather hold down that right mouse button all day and just, you know, draw little circles on their screen and just whirlwind through the whole thing and not have to worry about, oh, I need to hit this button to activate this to do that. But I think the devs, it's kind of one of those issues of like players versus devs, right? Like players kind of want to do the easiest route, and sometimes they don't even care if it's super fun, although they say that and then they get it, and then they might be like, I kind of wish there were more buttons to press. So that could also be a thing. We just have an unreliable feedback loop. But devs probably want to make, you know, something that is relatively cool and interesting and requires some, you know, press this to gain this effect, and it feels really interactive, right? I think they're always on the side of, we would want you to do more rather than boil everything down to one, you know, catch all, one skill does all the damage kind of system.
Yeah. Like, and just like going through and talking about like a player's expectations, I remember one of the comments to the post was one of their solutions or suggestions that they would make is, if you're having problems, going through and like balancing it or creating new stuff, why don't you add rune words?
What?
It's
Just
like,
out of left field.
yeah, it's just like, why don't you add rune words back into the game, and that will take care of your problem, because then you'll be able to go and like swap out your build and stuff like that. It's like, no, that's not how that works. That actually, in fact, will make it harder.
Would add so much, yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny.
No, they also did mention something that I kind of liked, is create monsters that are immune to certain elements or physical attacks. That was something that I appreciated in Diablo 2 from a developer aspect, because with the way that synergies worked, I'm just going to put everything into one tree and max it out and have like the most godly fireball and meteor on the face of the planet. So what's going to stop me from doing just that? Making monsters that are immune to fire.
Right.
So now, shit, I actually am forced to split out my synergies and also put something into, ice or lightning. I actually was forced to like dual spec. And then of course you go and you find the one that is frost fire immune. They were rare, but they were there, and then you're fucked.
And then you're like, I skip this area. Or save and exit.
There are some elemental immune mobs in Act 5. Are they actually immune or are they resistant? Because I have come across some mobs that are more resistant to one particular element, but not outright immune to it.
Yeah, I don't think there are any immunities in this game
Yeah. But
anymore.
that would be something that I would find a bit interesting. But the way that it's designed, with having elemental damage affixes, so that way you're buffing just like a single element, that it really it wouldn't definitely. That bringing that back would not work for Diablo 3, but maybe for a future like Diablo 4.
Yeah, it's oh, actually you also just reminded me of something else. So the whole optimization server, whatnot to improve, it kind of boils back into the whole D3 expansion versus D4 argument, contest, debate, whatever. If you're going with an expansion, you're still limited by, and again, it would help if we knew exactly what was causing issues, but you're still limited to the same engine. Most likely, a lot of the servers and issues that are gonna exist today will probably exist with a new expansion, right? So the idea there would be instead of designing brand new stuff. Well, I mean, you could still design brand new stuff, but I guess my point is that the optimization would come in the way that things were designed. So a counter, but then a counter to the counter is that if you put all the damage into Whirlwind, that's like a choice of design that helps with optimization, because if you say the tornadoes are the issue, or if rend is the issue, rend damage calculations, then if you take those out of the set, then technically you're optimizing through design, because now you're not behooved to use those methods anymore, and therefore you're not taxing the servers as much. But then I also just remembered, if you whirlwind something in general, there's actually a lot of damage ticks there as well too. Obviously they're not going to be as numerous and constant as like leaving a rend buff on something, because technically if you're not actively whirlwinding something, then it isn't having any ticks on it. Whereas you could like rend something over here, it has ticks now, and then you're over on the other side of the screen whirlwinding stuff. So I could see how that would be more taxing. But I guess even if my point is that even if you were to just push it all into Whirlwind, you could still actually run into, if you gather up enough monsters, issues where you have a lot of ticks calculating damage. And I guess the finishing side of this general argument is that if you go D4 route, then you get to redesign the whole engine, the servers used. Like, it doesn't necessarily just have to be optimization by design, but also like hardware optimization and things
Oh
like that.
yeah. Yeah, I remember that, because that was like one of the big things with World of Warcraft, is when they went through and they upgraded all of the original servers.
It must have been
And
a beautiful day.
Yeah, and that was one of those things that people would go through and bitch and complain about. Oh, X server's been updated and they've got rid of their performance issues, but nobody cares about Khadgar. Our server sucks. You know, it's like, we're the last on the list. We're never going to get upgraded. Like,
it's too funny.
Yep. It's like, it's coming. Wait. Just wait your turn.
You too will soon have this.
Yeah.
All right.
But, I think it's definitely something that they can go through and pick and tune. Because I feel like in Diablo 2, this is a soapbox I will never get off of. In Diablo 2, you know, elements kind of meant something more so than Diablo 3. You still generally kind of picked what was best, you know, like for, you know, a sorcerer, it would be, you know, kind of like you'd be like a meteor orb, you know, or maybe you did like a chain lightning meteor, you know, something along those lines. Right. You would kind of always pick like, this is like the best one. And then I have kind of like my off-spec damage to go through and get around stuff that's like fire immune, or, you know, this is just my one. This is my sorcerer for going through and farming Duras of Hatred, I'm using it to go through and kill the council, so it's like frozen orb, you know, or I'm wanting to go through and clear stuff in like the pit, so I'm using a lot of frozen orb. And if it rolled with some ice immune mobs when I went in there, I've got meteor to back me up just in case. Right. You know, but like now the only reason why you pick a particular type of elemental damage is because of the rune. Like you're specifically picking the element type because of the skill that you chose, not because of the element that it is. And so then you tack on the elemental damage on top of it as a boost. And I feel that, you know, it doesn't add all that much to the system. Yeah, it's something that, like, if you were to remove elemental damage, then you would probably take, like, attack speed or area damage on your amulet instead, and then you would take, you know, either, like, Lacunes for the attack speed, or maybe you would roll life per hit or all resist or armor on your bracers. You know, it's something that wouldn't really change the game all that much.
All right. And I think in a way they kind of, you could argue for or against this, I guess, as well, but you could say that they basically created the system, but through a different means, recreated the system, but through a different means, because now most builds, when you look at a traditional build of today, it's very functioned towards, you have one skill that's super powered, and that skill is supported by the set that you're wearing. Some builds have two skills that kind of work in tandem to make one better or to make the other better, to make them both kind of output equivalent damage. Mm-hmm. And so in that sense, you could kind of say, well, we're not necessarily like locked into, I dump 30 points into frozen orb, but then I also have my Nova in case I run into a cold immune. But on the other D3 side of things, it's I use multi-shot, and then sometimes I throw out an evasive fire to buff up my multi-shot. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It definitely is. And it's also just, if you added in, I would like to see like armor or resists like added into the system, like the mobs at least having some form of resist or armor, because then that adds in other affixes on your gear, such as reduction to enemy defense or reduction to enemy resistance, that you could then throw in to be a damage buff. But I don't know if they'd ever do that, because that type of stuff is not something that you could easily see apparent as how much it's going to increase the effectiveness of your character, much like area damage, where you know for the longest time area damage, oh, it's useless, and then area damage is now like, oh, that shit's good. You want that on your shoulders. You want to try and get a lot of that for almost like all classes now. It's, even though it gives you 0% increase on your character damage screen, it's now gone through and be like, oh no, you need it. You want a lot of it, in fact.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and that's just something that a lot of the best affixes that you could have in D2 did absolutely nothing. Not like your character sheet damage meant anything at all in Diablo 2. It was more useless than Diablo 3, but it was at least something that, you know, you would get all these buffs and like none of them would actually show on your character sheet damage, because you'd have, you know, like like say a poison necromancer. You'd have items that reduce enemies' poison resistance, and then you'd also go through and have like faster, what was it? Faster recovery rate for your quicker block animation and all this other stuff, that didn't have anything to do with your actual damage, but they helped improve your character. It were necessary stats in the game. Like if you were gonna go through and have like a 75 block chance on a character in D2, you were getting your recovery animation down to as few frames as you possibly can. So there's always a sweet spot. But if you're running a shield build and you want the 75% block chance, well then you've got to have 78%, recovery speed. To drop it down to like 6 frames, stuff like that.
Yeah, I think it would be interesting to see in a D4 or whatever the next game is, them open up the affix pool, because I think what you're getting at is when you have more choices, not only does that mean that your gear is going to look a little more unique, especially since we have methods in D3 which weren't available in D2 to really customize and modify our gear. You could do it to some degree in D2, but like here, it's, we really have an NPC that helps drive that home. And so you could actually make some pretty serious choices to say, all right, I have this like perfect Shaco or perfect Storm Shield, or I don't, choose your item, right? And it has a bunch of affixes that are really good, but I need this one particular one. So now I go to my Enchantress or my Mystic. And I'm like, all right, I want this instead. But now you're making a huge sacrifice because you look at your pool of affixes and it's like, 8 pages long. And you could choose a lot of really great options. But at the end of the day, you have to kind of pick one. And now you're, limiting the ways that you could affect that item in the future. And I think when you start to get a lot more of those tough choices, it complicates the game a lot, which I think you were kind of getting at too, with the whole like your sheet doesn't necessarily represent the power of your character accurately. Which is bad if they're trying to appeal to the wider masses and the, I think.
Yeah, because that is something that they did in D3 is they wanted to make the choices a lot more visible. And that's something that we've had developer posts about and dev talks and BlizzCon and game development conference or convention, the JDC, there they've talked about making the readability of items better is a major accomplishment that they've had in D3 from launch to now, and something that they've improved upon the system from D2. So that way your character sheet does actually mean something. Nowadays it's not so much. I remember when we used to get all at the beginning of Reaper of Souls, where we would get emails all the time. Well, what How much damage should I have, to get into Torment 6? It's like what damage should I have? It's like, oh, 1 million, 2 million, something like that. But now it's, I feel like I had characters that had more damage at the beginning of Reaper of Souls than I do now. And I barely skirt 1 million, but can still clear, Greater Rift 65 without any issues. So it like that damage, kind of like means less, and I feel like I can clear a higher greater rift like on a Witch Doctor with lower damage than I can on my Demon Hunter, and it all depends on how your set bonuses affect and work and your skills and stuff. But I'm not sure if they ever will put in things like like the old recovery rate or reduced enemy defense or reduced enemy resists back into the game, just because it's not going to have that readability. It is going to make the game more complicated, and I'm not sure if that's something that they actually want or not. Because they had armor reduction in Wrath of the Lich King for World of Warcraft. And when they went into Cataclysm, they removed it. And the reason why they did, it was just too mathy. It was the absolute best DPS stat that you could have up until this particular level, and then it dropped off, and then this stat became better until you had this much, so then you need this much more, armor reduction, and then at this point it's useless and you don't want it anymore. And it just is like you couldn't actually see how it improved your character. You had no idea, is this actually improving my damage or not? I really don't know. And so they just removed it because it was too complicated and caused too much confusion.
Well, here's my kind of like final thoughts on this, right? Is you can build a system, and I'm saying like, oh, just build the system. Obviously, very
Just
difficult.
add rune words.
Yeah. Come on, rune words. End of story, slash thread. You can build a system, I believe, that is at the same time simplistic, easy to get into, easy to understand, but adds complexities for the players that want to get there. I think when you start to like generalize your player base too much, then you lower your level of expectation of them. And so to some degree, you're saying now, well, we don't think that they'll be able to handle. I kind of feel like this was a major issue with the development of the original D3. It was like, well, we don't think that they're going to be able to handle X, so we're going to tell them that it should look like this because we think that's going to be better for all players. And there wasn't that like give and take of the feedback. I think if you tie the system towards being simple to get into, then the people who aren't even going to go nearly as far as like end game min-maxing perfect optimization, they'll get a good enjoyment out of it because they'll understand how it works. They'll be able to say, okay, I know my character looks this way for this reason. It performs the way it does. Great. But then someone who, like you or me, who wants to run a podcast and get really deep into the mechanics, we might want a system layered on top of that. Now, like, open up a sphere grid for us and we can start to customize more of these affixes or more of the way that our gear interacts with our skills. And that way, you're adding a layer of depth that doesn't make it so simplistic to say, I just add more critical hit chance, I do more damage. But maybe stats that aren't as apparent, we trust that they're doing more because we've kind of given ourselves the agency to do the math on it and believe in the system and discover it through the system.
Yeah, it is going to be, it's obviously every game has always had that share. Oh, you're dumbing it down too much to make it more accessible, and so you're losing your hardcore audience. But it's always going to be that balance because,
They're the minority.
they are the minority. But, what is it you're going to do? And something like that, with how you actually design like the itemization system or like the skill system, is something that you can't have like two completely different like skill systems, one for the casual player and then one for the like the super hardcore player. You can't have one person that's picking out of a talent tree of like five choices and another person have like a Path of Exile sphere grid, in the same game. But
Elective mode.
yeah.
I mean
True.
that kind of was that, right?
Yeah.
Hey, how come this guy's build has three things from the defensive category? We still see
And
that
it,
question
you, I was just
sometimes.
about to say, yeah, you still see that on the forums every once in a while. It's like, holy shit. I had a friend that like had played Diablo in the beginning at release, the like vanilla D3, and then like just came back to Reaper of Soul in season 6, and I was like playing for the first time, and he asked me that question. Hey, I'm going through and I see this wizard guide, but he's like pulling like two skills from, I forget which one it was, which skills it was. He was running Delseers, but it's like he's pulling these two skills from like the same selection. How is that possible? And it's like you go in and you turn on elective mode. It's under gameplay. It's like, oh, okay, cool, thanks. It's just it's true. It's a thing,
It's still a thing. Yeah. So I mean that was just kind of funny that you mentioning that kind of brought, rung that up in my head. But I wonder if they kind of were having this conversation that we're having right now, and they're like, okay, well, we kind of solved the issue by uncomplicating it by making there only be so many choices.
Yeah, but then the thing is, we wouldn't have this problem, or you wouldn't get these questions if it was just elective mode.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah,
So it wasn't like a.
if you didn't have that more simplistic system and you just had it full open, because the questions that these people are having is because they have gone out and they're looking for these answers. It's okay if you go through and you have it set into those particular categories on your skill bar as you level specifically. And, when you go to click and change the skill, it's going to pop up for that one particular skill in that category. And then, for this what the hardcore person thinks, like this casual gamer is, you know, the person that is like drooling all over their keyboard, clicking the screen, eventually they might notice there's little arrows. Oh, I can change the category on these skills, you know, type thing. Yep. But, you know, it's, I think, you know, elective mode probably should have just been the default option.
Right. And then, yep. Yeah. I mean, hopefully, like, this is something that we've mentioned previously. And actually, this leads into, oh, this is so beautiful. So, you just mentioned, oh, I'm losing it now. You just mentioned, the choices that they made at the beginning, and potentially they thought they were well-intentioned, but then, you know, potentially it turned out to not be so great. We had, you found, this game developer podcast, I guess? SoundCloud page? Where these guys go and interview developers in the gaming industry and just talk about different topics. I think they themselves are developers. And so, you know, they're kind of like schmoozing, elbows, all that good stuff with some of their fellow peers. And just talk about a wide variety of topics. I actually saw some of the ones that I hadn't listened to that were not pertinent to our interest, but they looked really interesting. But in any case, the idea here is they interviewed Jay Wilson.
Yes, yes. Now, I'm just full transparency. Even though I did find it, I've not yet listened to it.
Okay.
Yes, so you're going to be taking this one solo.
I will lead us down this road then.
Yep, I got about 5 minutes into the intro, and I just, it's like one of those things, like, whenever you go through and talk about, like, the Netflix build, I cannot do the Netflix build. I'm either playing the game and completely shutting out whatever is playing in the background, or I'm listening to the podcast or watching the show and not playing the game. I cannot focus. I will be sitting there playing and realize, wait, it's silent. Has an hour gone by? I didn't even hear them in the show. I have no idea what the hell that they talked about.
You missed the whole train.
Yeah.
You're still on the platform. All right. Well, yep. I got you. There honestly wasn't too much meat on the bone here, so it's not something that we have to languish on. I'm throwing the page up on the screen right now in case people want to take a look. The podcast is named Game Dev Unchained, and this is episode 46 that we're talking about specifically. Yep. Go ahead.
And what I was just going to say, the one thing that I did go through and research a little bit about, that this is a show like by a couple of game developers about the game development industry. And this particular episode, they focused a lot upon dealing with burnout, and that's even something that they talk about like in the opening. And just like any other profession, you can go through and think, oh, game development, that must be awesome, but you can definitely get burnt out on it, especially working at Blizzard, where people can sometimes been known to sleep in their office when they get into crunch time just because they're working 18-hour days.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So that really was the crux of the discussion here. They were mainly talking about just what do you do to avoid it. You know, one of the points Jay made was that like the first 5 years is really the toughest. And if you can make it beyond the five, then you're kind of like...
it had absolutely nothing to do with boredom. Please. I promise you. It's just I was playing Legion. You know, it's like it was interesting to go through and listen to, but it was just... You know, it was like one of those points where it's like, I have to turn it off because I'm trying to listen to it. And so I'm just sitting here staring at this quest giver. And, you know, I have to turn it off so I can continue to play. That's just, I can't do it. I'm sorry.
Right. And so in general, there wasn't too much specific Diablo talk. He referenced his time at Blizzard, obviously, because that was one of the places he was at for the longest. I believe he stated his time there was like 8 years, or potentially was 8 years working on D3. But he mentioned, you know, the fact that he moved around a bit. He did some stuff for a while. Legion, actually.
Titan.
Cool. Yep. Yeah.
We did kind of learn about that after he had moved on from Diablo, he was working on an undisclosed project. Well, that was basically Titan. He was working on Titan until it got scrapped. And then apparently he just kind of mentioned it offhandly, but he, you know, worked on Legion. So I imagine after Titan was scrapped, he went to work with the WoW team.
Mm-hmm. And so they were generally just questioning him about, you know, moving around from different places because he also came from Relic Games, which I learned, by the way, was like a basic mini Blizzard before many of the designers and developers over there made it to Blizzard, because Josh Mascara actually worked with Jay Wilson on Dawn of War, and he actually credited him in this episode of like really helping to finish that game up. I guess Josh did a lot of the story elements for that game, which I found to be really fascinating because no one has talked about that tie-in. And it was kind of weird because that was, you know, how many years ago, and then, you know, forsooth into the future, he would hand over Diablo 3 to him basically, years down the road. But also Andrew Chambers was there as well too, and he's someone that has been pretty instrumental on Diablo development. So I just it's weird how all these people, I guess it's a really small world when it comes to game development perhaps. But that was mainly it, to be perfectly honest with you. He did one thing actually, you know, he didn't talk about people in specific or anything like that, you know, wasn't trying to burn any bridges. But one thing I found really interesting was that he made a clear point to state that, you know, game development happens as a team. And it's very much, you know, he can have an idea of how things are going to go or how they're supposed to go, but the team has input. And at the end of the day, he's kind of like signing off on things, but the team is really pushing stuff out the door. It's these decisions that everyone is contributing towards, so everyone is kind of responsible for them, but he's kind of like the quarterback, so you know his name is the one that's really going to be out there. He's the one doing all these pre-release interviews and things. So I just felt it interesting because it felt like he was talking very much directly to the people who just dump on him to say, oh, D3 sucks because Jay Wilson, you know?
Yeah, the people that are still, yeah, fuck that guy.
Right, in so many words. But this episode's certainly worth a listen. I found it to be interesting, especially for what we do here. You know, we tend to talk about a lot of the behind the scenes without being direct participants in it. So this kind of pulled the curtain back a little bit. And that is all I have to say on that topic. Segueing over, we did have a quick blue post from a couple of days ago from Nevelistus that let us know that our forums are going to be updated soon. Woo, new shinies.
Yay.
So she noted that if we're familiar with any of the other forums, many of them have received updates, like the WoW forums. They look pretty interesting. I guess I can actually pull that up too. So you can see it on screen for those of us watching live or watching the video. But she also noted that they're going to be taking some feedback on, you know, the changes and things like that, and if there are going to be bugs with the changeover, etc. So, you know, the whole idea is that they want to make the community process better, and the forums really exist to bring the community together to talk to each other. As such, they're going to kind of use this opportunity to peer down on some of the different topics and subtopics and things like that. But they are taking, again, suggestions and comments and critiques to kind of make sure that this process is good for everyone involved. But if you want to see, this is what the World of Warcraft forums currently look like. And if you're familiar with the Diablo 3 ones, you know this looks very different. And if you pop in here, it's all like very central. Go ahead.
But one thing that I do want to point out, look at the gameplay forums and what stands out to you. Very top.
Gameplay and guides. Returning player help, professions, garrisons. Garrisons? Are those like not?
No, that's Legion, but back on the list of Diablo forums that are going to
Oh.
be coming.
Items and crafting, hardcore, brawling, lore, and story.
Yep.
Lore?
No.
Brawling?
Yes.
Are you just gonna comment like we don't need the brawling one?
Kind of. Yeah, have you ever actually been to the brawling forums?
I can't say that I have ever visited it.
Yeah, I just happened to stop back there when they made this blue post just to see. It's I kind of even though I check them, you know, periodically, you know, I never really have ever clicked on the brawling one, and I just clicked on it, and like almost every single post on it is, are we ever going to get PvP in Diablo 3? You know, what could they do to make PvP in Diablo 3? You know, what could we do to make PvP balanced in Diablo 3? You know, are we going to get PvP? It's just all that it is when are we getting PvP? You know, it's like, I think that they could probably do without that particular forum.
But tinfoil hat, maybe this one is continuing forward because there are plans in future patches to make brawling even better than it has ever been.
Coming in 1.10. Or sorry, 1.1.
1.1.
1.1.
I'm not saying it's going to be PvP, but I'm saying they could like add a whole new brawling map, and then the three people that play will ask their friend to come and try it with them.
That doesn't, you know, they're actually, I'm surprised that they haven't done it, because they did have, I want to say they had two other fully complete arena maps for PvP. There was the one that was a lot like Magda's Lair that you could play at BlizzCon, you know, before the game launched, to try out the 5v5 deathmatch arenas that they had, which I'm surprised they never actually added that one in as like another option that you could do for brawling. You know, and I want to say that there was one other one that they kind of showed off, but I don't think it was ever playable. I'm not sure if it was finished for them to go and, you know, throw in that.
Wait, are you done? What?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you said throw in that, and I was like, dot, 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 throw in that what? That map.
If they were to go through and like throw in those particular maps, gotcha, you know, into the brawling category, you know, so that way you could have a couple different choices.
I mean,
you know, it's like they could even go through and just take a little bit of time and make an act specific brawling map for each act, so that way you could go and, you know, talk to what's his name, Gnar?
Neck.
But neck brawler, you
don't know because you don't brawl. What if they already did that? What if it's already in the game?
It is not.
I don't know. All right, go to Act 5 right now.
Okay, let me know what you find.
I'm not gonna do that. But no, you're right. I guess maybe they're not motivated to do it because who would do it? Who would use it? But I mean, maybe there are people out there. Okay, so I have to believe that they're keeping that forum around beyond using that place to catch all of the worst PvP posts, because maybe there really are people who actually do brawl a little bit, time to time, once every season. I don't know. It could benefit them, but then if they're using, I don't know how much dev resources it would take, but like, you know, I'd rather them work on the Wrath of the Waste set.
If all things were considered equal.
Right.
Yeah.
So, anyways.
But hey, we can definitely go through and hope that if they are developing Diablo 4, that they will make PvP a major function within the game.
Mm-hmm. And you actually have some really interesting thoughts on that, so maybe we'll
I will write that article one day, but if not, we can always just do it on an episode.
Yep. All right, coming attractions. And then the only other thing that I have news-wise was for those who love music and the music of Blizzard, they actually added to streaming services, confirmed to be on Spotify and Apple Music, potentially. I don't know if they talked to Jay-Z and got that on, almost at Tinder, on Tidal just yet. But if you go...
Now I want to see like a Duriel Tinder profile.
Enjoys ripping the heads off of...
If pain is your game, I'm your man,
oh,
you know?
Oh my god. This got real. If you go to Spotify or Apple Music, you can haphazardly, unfortunately, search for the different soundtracks. Because they're not under any particular artist, it makes it kind of difficult to find them. But if you know some of the perennial Blizzard music producers, like Glenn Stafford or Dukes or Brower or, you know, any of those peeps, you can throw their name in and soundtracks will pop up. But you can also just look for the soundtrack you're looking for, so you can just type in World of Warcraft Legion, it'll bring up Legion, Diablo 3, etc. For those who are on Spotify, I actually created a playlist that combined all of the soundtracks together, so that can be a good starting point if you then want to make your own playlist and only take like the StarCraft ones out of there or something. But pretty cool. I mean, it's interesting because I think they still sell these CDs on their site, but I guess now you can also stream them if you own any of those services.
Yeah, then yeah, they've had a lot of the CDs. They usually always include it in the collector's editions. They have the digital copies. They've loaded to iTunes for quite a few years now.
So I'll probably be having those as some sort of stream background music one of these days. Check out music from the other games I don't play.
Yeah, you could go through and look up Matt Uelmen's work on Burning Crusade and listen to the original music composed for Diablo 3 at Blizzard North.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go. Oh, also, I had left room on our notes here because I'm talked a lot about Gamescom last episode, but you weren't here to talk about that with me as well. So, do you have general thoughts about what we saw at Gamescom? What we didn't see, maybe, or just any tinfoil hat theories that were furthered or quashed?
I think it would be more just following up on the points that you made in the episode last week about people just misconstruing the Diablo tweet about BlizzCon's going to be really cool this year. One where you specifically address that. They didn't actually answer the question. Are we going to get any major announcements at BlizzCon? And then the response is BlizzCon is cool, so it's like a non-answer.
Right.
They didn't confirm or deny anything in that particular tweet, but it created this huge fluff. And I actually had a discussion with someone on Twitter about it, who, just like you were saying, that they part of their argument was, that they're hyping this up. So if they don't announce a new game or a new expansion, any backlash that they get is deserved on them because they're going through and creating hype for nothing. And it's like this, they're the most likely scenario that we're going to have is that it's going to be a huge celebration for all things Diablo because it's the 20th anniversary. We've seen in the past that Blizzard, has gone like all out for their 20th and 25th anniversaries. That when it's something like this, that they're gonna like really go into it. I mean, they have these huge champagne parties every time that they launch a new title. They're really big into celebrating their accomplishments, and the 20th, milestone, for the franchise is a big moment that they're gonna want to have some sort of, big shindig for you. And to say that, oh, well, if you're not going to announce a new game, then you're not allowed to be excited about that. It's like asinine. It's
Right.
like there can be things that they can be excited about that's not a new announcement. And when I brought that up, their counterpoint was, oh, but they were specifically addressing or replying to a tweet that was asking them about a new game. It's like, no, it wasn't. They were just asking if there was going to be any huge Diablo related announcements at BlizzCon.
Right.
And then now you're just assuming that that means, are they going to announce a new game? Like you're reading too much into it. You're putting words in their mouth and building up your own expectations. And so when, of course, it doesn't get Diablo 4 isn't delivered at BlizzCon, it's Blizzard's fault.
Yeah. Thunderclaw actually had a bunch of posts when Gamescom was happening live a couple weeks back where he mentioned that, Blizzard didn't tell us to look for this like stuff that you're angry that isn't happening at Gamescom. Like their disclosure on events that were happening was there's going to be a couple of community streams. We're doing an art presentation and Wyatt will be there. And all those things turned out to be true.
And you're going to be able to play Diablo 1, 2, and 3 from the show floor, and we're getting ready for Diablo's 20th anniversary.
Exactly. And all those things were on representation. They all happened, but there was still this huge vitriol of like, oh, it's nothing. Like this sucks. They didn't give us information. And Thunderclaw's point in his post was really interesting in that he know the community has a really good job. Does a really good job of hyping itself up and then getting mad when the hype isn't met. And it just points back to this singular instance that you had where it's very easy, I think, for people to read what they want to read into what's like not on the page at all. And I feel like we do it here like every day, right? Like we're looking, you know, in between the lines to say like, oh, is it going to mean something or not? But I think we're also still being realistic to understand that at the end of the day, like we pretty much end a lot of our tinfoil hat discussions with, well, we don't know. We'll see.
Yeah.
Because you can't afford to have these expectations put on them when they're not putting it on themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They're not putting it out into the public to say, we will deliver something. And we always say it, like, they don't tell us really until they're like 99.999% sure it's happening, right? Like, they know already.
They don't even put it out until it is 100% confirmed that is in fact happening, you know?
Well, except for D3.
Except for D3. that gosh darn talisman and mystic.
Mm.
Yeah. Well, the mystic, I guess, eventually did make its way in. And the Kanai's cube kind of functions as the talisman.
There you go. So delivered.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's just some of those things. And I will say it all the way up into BlizzCon. If they actually announce anything major, I will be pleasantly surprised. But I do believe that this will just be a focus and a celebration of the franchise as a whole. You know, just looking back at the whole, you know, journey and just celebrating, you know, everything Diablo. And that is just like looking at what we know, like, you know, Josh leaving, them looking for a games director. Mm-hmm. The art director has been there, you know, for less than a year. I'm not exactly sure when they were hired. Was it like February-ish?
Your guess is as good as mine.
Yeah. I actually don't even know who the art director is that they hired.
I don't think it's been announced.
Yeah. I don't know if anybody knows the particular answer to that question, you know, but they're still looking for, you know, senior concept artists and stuff like that. So they're still, whatever it is that they are working on, they're in the conceptual phase, and they don't actually need the devs working on it because they've been shuffled to other teams to help out, you know, for the time being. You know, so it's not like they're getting ready to announce anything tomorrow, mm-hmm. which in the grand scheme of things, you know, BlizzCon is only 2 months away. So it's not like they're going to have any massive paradigm shifts within the development of whatever this project is that they'll be ready to announce it by then. Right. You know, so I do not see them hinting or teasing anything, because like you were just saying, they don't announce or show anything till it's already been, you know, like polished and you know, ready to display. That they're not going to go through every time that they announce a new game or title, it's playable,
right?
You know, so that is what it is, unless they make a huge shift in their company policy to go through and say, you know, hey, well, you know, it's like we're gonna continue the Diablo trend. We're gonna announce this game 5 years before it comes out.
That worked well last time.
You know, exactly. Huh.
A quick question for you though. Yeah. While we're on the topic of BlizzCon, do you remember about when we got the maps and everyone, you know, started to be like, oh, it's the Diablo area is smaller than the bathroom.
Was it? I want to say it was leaked. It got a leak at the end of September. It was not so much that it was leaked. It went up. The BlizzCon site was updated and it went live briefly for a couple minutes. But that was all that was needed for people to go through and grab screenshots and show on like MMO Champion. And then it ended up being confirmed when they officially posted it later in October.
Gotcha.
So yeah, I want to say it was
to wait on that.
Yeah, I want to say that they officially announced it only like a couple weeks before the convention. It was like mid-late October. Right. It was only like 2 or 3 weeks in advance, I think.
More waiting to do then.
Yeah.
Because that'll really be our next, I think, big thing that we're looking for in terms of signs of what's to come. You know, you see this big hall of unmarked territory. Oh my god, it's World of Murkablo.
It's happening!
So, I'm looking forward to it. We'll get there. We will get there, even if it takes a few years. Don't worry, friends. In it for the long haul. All
right. Mm-hmm.
Any other tinfoil hat theories you want to get off before we go community feedback section.
I like Miss Cheetah's comment in chat. I want a legendary tinfoil hat in the game.
Ha!
The forums had suggested it a few years ago.
I'm surprised we don't have something like that. That'd actually be great. It
wasn't that... I think that that was actually one of their April Fool's jokes for World of Warcraft. It was when they released the WoW armory, they had a April Fool's joke where you could have like a tinfoil hat that would like block out your character on the armory. Yeah, it was something like that. So it'd be funny. I'd approve of it.
I'm totally down. Big fan. All right, so time for emails. Guess what? There are no emails. Woo, that was quick. All the emails this week. And I obviously understand that it has only been a week, so you guys are used to the 2 weeks.
Even then, you can also kind of go through and blame me because I didn't get the episode up until Saturday.
Even still, though, people know where to find us.
Yeah.
They should be emailing us to talk. But in any case, it's just a bunch of items, which is awesome. We actually have a return to something that is hilarious, so I can't wait for that. But, Mr. Nineball, we teased this previously that we had something to give away and we needed to come up with a contest for it, and now we have a contest
that we do.
Yes. Okay, so this contest will challenge your knowledge of just how closely you pay attention to the Westmarch workshop. The prize at hand, again donated by an anonymous listener of the show. Really awesome for them to do this, so thank you very much. You know who you are. They donated a virtual ticket code, which will allow you to watch BlizzCon 2016 from the comfort of your home. Mm-hmm. If you cannot attend in person, or if you just want to watch it in person while you're at your hotel, you know, hanging out, taking a break, doesn't really matter. And it will also grant you the in-game goodies when those get announced. I feel like we still don't know what those are just yet, unfortunately, but it's a pretty cool prize, you know, $40 worth from what you can buy on the site right now. And we're going to give it away to you guys. If you can answer us this question.
Before you must pass, you must first answer me these questions three.
Except we made it easy.
Except it's only, yeah, and it's only one question.
It's just one question.
Yeah.
All right.
But Monty Python reference. So.
I loved it and actually got it.
There we go. Yes. Yes, we found a movie.
Bang. So the question at hand, everyone pay attention. We are asking you to tell us, email into the show, westmarchworkshop@blizzpro.com, which podcast did we hang out with at BlizzCon 2015? Diablo podcast, because yes, there were many podcasts, and we also attended World of Podcasts, so that could get kind of crazy. Yeah,
That would be a multiple answer scenario in that right. particular one.
And name them all. I don't even know what all the names would be. But there were two podcasts, Diablo podcasts, in attendance at the show, at least that we know of. And we got to hang out and talk and took some pictures and stuff. So if you were paying attention, we talked about it on the show. There's some stuff out there. You can do your research. You know the dates, so you can go back and listen as well. But we will take all the answers. Every answer that is correct will then be entered into the pit of correct answers. We will randomly choose from those correct answers one lucky winner. And we will also do that on stream so you know that there's no malarkey or shenanigans or who's a what's it's going on.
Yep. I do like how you said the pit. Was that an intentional Diablo 2 reference?
It wasn't, but I'm going to just edit that part when I said it wasn't, yep. And yeah, it was.
It was. It totally was.
Exactly.
Yep. Because exactly. The pit was one of those places that could get the monster level of 109 and drop everything, and they get, never mind. Continue.
All right.
All right.
So you have your marching orders. We're giving you about a month, because next episode, of course, is the special 100th. Woo! And we, oh boy, do we have some stuff in store for you in episode 100. So do not miss that 2 weeks from today. But we probably will not do contest stuff then. So you will have some additional time here in case you don't catch this episode right away before that next one. So episode 101, we will do the live drawing of the winner of the virtual ticket. So get excited.
Woot.
Woot, woot, woot. All right, and with that, How about some items of the
week.
week? And that might be changing too in the future. What? No promises
No promises.
though.
No
So,
promises.
all right. So you're seeing on your screen here for the first time ever, just kidding, it's the return of the ancient furnace. You guys remember, we used to get these all the time back in the day, and it was actually a running joke that we would continue to show ancient furnaces until we no longer received ancient furnaces. So I guess technically I should just skip this, right?
Oh, totally.
Yeah, moving right along then. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. This one came in from Juno Reactor, and he had a little story for us. It says, "Sup, fellas, found a really good ancient furnace, although I am not going to use it." And he told me the stats, and I will read those out for you. So, ancient furnace, 4,533.8 DPS, a rerolled perfect 10% damage modifier, 1,463 intelligence, a perfect attack speed increase by 7%, and then secondaries of monster kills grant plus 230 experience. The legendary power that we all know and love, increased damage against elites by a perfect 50%. And then a Rama Llama Ding Dong Happy Meal for a socket with a max level emerald in there for crit damage, 130%. So thank you, Juno Reactor, for starting us again on this streak. I think we should keep it going. So if you guys find some ancient furnaces out there, let's make magic happen. Keep submitting them. We're gonna do this
Keep
again.
them coming.
Yep. Just when you think we're moving forward after episode 100, we're just actually going back.
To the future?
Ooh, more movie references.
There we go.
Next up on the list, some awesome pants. You would want to put your body in these if you could, but you can't because they belong to Echo. Echo has sent in Jade Harvester's Courage, which are ancient Jade Harvester pants. He notes
Are those the pants?
they are the pants.
The healing pants?
I don't know if they'll heal you, but he actually does call them the pants.
Yeah, sorry, that is a reference to illegal Danish,
Sounds
which a
dank.
World of Warcraft thing.
All right. I like it. Dank memes.
Dank memes.
Hey, is Westmarch Workshop team. Here are the pants for my little witch doctor. First decent item that I got from Kadala this season. I know it's only a set item, but since I got these pants, there was nothing was as it was before. The pockets have the perfect size to carry all the health globes that our support barb generates. I will never take these pants off. They are awesome. Thank you for that, Echo. He has stats on these, and the stats are 645 intelligence, which is 5 off of perfect, a reroll vitality of 640, and that's 10 off perfect, 695 armor, which of course is excellent for witch doctors since they get so much aures from their insanely boosted intelligence. A Call to Sans Despair with a rank 88. It's pretty solid. 440 intelligence being added from that. A secondary of 188 cold resistance, and also increased golden health pickup by 2 yards, which of course synergizes with a lot of the passives and things that witch doctors use, so that's pretty good. And then 2 sockets on there, which are also stuffed to the brim with 2 max level topaz gems for 280 intelligence each. So I think, like, spitballing this. These pants alone are providing like I don't know, 9,000, like 1,645 intelligence, I think, if I did the math right. A lot of intelligence. These are really smart pants.
Very, very smart pants. Smarty pants.
Oh, there it is. I didn't think of that. You're so smart.
Dun-dun-tsh.
Hey. And then last but not least, we have an item sent in from Jeff, a Ring of Emptiness. More Witch Doctor love. He notes, actually, he loved this item so much, he sent it in twice, so I have 2 emails to read. He says, "Sup, fellas, this dropped early in season, and I've been playing Jade. Lots of fun blowing things up in massive fashion. Saving my gems for augments, so I will re-roll the critical hit damage to 50% someday." So, spoilers, critical hit damage is on here, and it's not 50. "Still missing the ancient vile hive, but I will keep hunting." Oh, actually, this is from Net Smasher, whose name also happens to be Jeff. I'm sorry if I revealed your name by mistake. But he sent it twice under two
Tuck it down.
aliases. Crazy. Crazy. Maybe he has a split personality. Anyways, he loves the jade lifestyle. And this item here, Ancient Ring of Emptiness, 581 intelligence, a rerolled critical hit damage, like we mentioned, of 35% here, which he says one day will eventually be 50, a perfect critical hit chance of 6%, secondaries of 6,541 life after each kill. And then, of course, the legendary power, which was boosted in this patch. He got a perfect 300% increased damage to enemies affected by both your haunt and locust swarm. And then, of course, a socket on here that came naturally, which he has slotted with an esoteric alteration that's at rank 70. And of course, everyone remembers that this is the Ring of Controversy, the Ring of Empty Feelings, Empty Promises. I guess that's kind of in the game already, Broken Promises. When it was so ninjaly hotfixed the day before Season 7 started. But a lot of people, of course, are using it the way it was intended now, which is in Jade and doing a lot of damage. So it's good. And that was the last item of the week. And the end of our show.
Oh, there we are.
How about that?
Yeah. And just to answer Longshot's questions from chat, yes, we got your email and oh man.
Dude, when I
Oh
saw that
man.
email, I sent a text to Nineball and I was like, yo, get hype, man. This is that was we're obviously gonna talk about it next episode because it's way more
Fitting
relevant.
for that
Yes.
one, yeah.
But dude, thank you for that, because it
Forget.
helped.
Yeah, we're gonna have to like put in like a dedication page at the end of the next show. It's like all this stuff that we're going through and talking about for the last couple of weeks about doing on the show and like going through and looking up. Oh, well, Longshot went and did all of it for us
Right?
without even asking.
Yeah. It's good to have good friends.
Yep.
All right, man. So anything, any other words, last words before we wrap? Do we have any new 5-star reviews? Is everyone satisfied?
Does it seems that way. I actually was gonna go through and comment on that one in the closing segment that we actually we it's been a while since we've had any reviews. It's been March, I think, was our last review
Uh-oh.
that we had. Yeah, so by all means, we definitely appreciate any feedback or reviews or updates, 5-star ratings that you can give to us like on iTunes or Stitcher. It helps with the visibility of the show within the community. So, it's definitely helps us out.
And we're kicking things up a notch. Like, now is actually the perfect time to deliver feedback because we're at that precipice. Episode 100 is coming. We cannot avoid it. We have tried for 99 episodes to avoid 100, but we got here somehow.
We even went through and changed the format to bi-weekly to push it off for as long as possible.
And we still made it. So, I mean, at that point, it's like, hey, we can make some changes. I think there will be fancy new graphics and things. So, stuff to look forward to, of course. But yeah, if you have like serious feedback, we're always listening to it, but especially right now, we're going to be very receptive because we're ready to step it up for the next 100 episodes to be even better than the last. And I guess with that, I don't have anything else to add, so I'm ready for you to take us home, good sir, like you always
All
do.
right. Yeah, well, as always, if you have any comments or feedback that you'd like to go through and send into the show, you want your items to be showcased, just send us an email, westmarchworkshop@blizzpro.com. But you can also go through and chat with us on Twitter. The official show Twitter account is at the WM Workshop. And then, of course, you can catch our live stream here every other Wednesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific at
Nine.
twitch.tv
Sorry.
slash BlizzPro. Yeah, you got
I
me.
ruined your flow. I'm sorry, man.
That's okay. That's okay. I'll forgive you this time.
Okay.
Nine?
Nine.
999.
99.
But yep. And while you're at our Twitch page, you can go ahead and hit the subscribe button or the follow button down there at the bottom to go through and check out. Because it's not just us; we also have a large number of podcasts that cover like the full range of the Blizzard world. Sunday nights we have the Well Met podcast that covers everything Hearthstone. Tuesday night is the Heroes Power Hour covering Heroes of the Storm, and Thursday nights is the Payload, our Overwatch podcast. Because you should always get to the Payload. input. But we're even in game. You can go through and do a search for us. We are the BlizzPro clan, and I believe we actually do have some open spots at the moment. Mm-hmm. As things were a bit quiet this season. If you don't want to leave your current clan, you can always join our in-game community. You can just do a search for Westmarch Workshop to find us there. And then you can also go through and, you know, find a lot of the topics that we talked about and more over at our homepage, diablo.blizzpro.com. You can also hang out and chat with us. I haven't been in it too much lately. A lot of real life stuff going on. But there's the discord.gg/blizzpro is our official voice chat server, not just for the show, but for all things BlizzPro. And if you want to follow us individually, you can go through and follow me on Twitter. I'm at NineBallGamer, and Leviathan is at LeviathanD3, and you stream occasionally from time to time.
I do. I've been bad about it lately, unfortunately. But also, I feel like it's fair to say that I've been taking some time to kind of recharge the batteries a little bit. I actually just got a gym membership yesterday, so I'm really excited about that.
Mine expires tomorrow.
Oh, look at that.
Yep.
We're on, like, similar cycles, but different.
Right. It's the same, but different.
But different, yeah.
It's the opposite. It's the yin and the yang.
But yes, I will use my stream to stream when I stream. And if you would like to follow the stream down the stream, rowing your boat gently, then you can go to twitch.tv/leviathan111 and follow, hang out, check it out. It's going to be good when it happens. Sometimes it happens.
Sometimes. Maybe not. Maybe.
All right. But the next time we see you guys, we'll be 100 years old. That's how that works, right?
Yeah, something like that. Close to it. Yeah. Yeah.
And you know what they say. You're not nothing unless you're something.
Okay. I did not know that is what they did it.
You're a dick.
What a dick. Last time with these overlays, say bye.
Bye, overlays.
Bye.
Hope you find your overlays.
What about your underlays?
What about the regular lays?
What about just the lays?
Potato chips.
D's lays?
D's lays. Alright, okay, I think we're done. Somewhere in there, you'll have to find a cutting point. Or just include it all, I don't know.
Oh, that cutting point has not come yet.